as quilters, a lot of times we're always looking for last minute gifts that are relatively quick to make and stuff. And really, I got to tell you, this polar fleece, quilted polar fleece blanket goes together so quickly. It's amazing. So just bear with me because I wrote a bunch of stuff out here. I'm going to go through it and we'll take it from there. So what you need is 2 pieces of polar fleece that's at least 60 inches wide and about 2 yards long or longer. And the one that I'm going to show in the photos today, I made for my son, who's like 6'6". So I think I did 3 yards of polar fleece. So it was long and narrow, but it keeps him warm. And that's all that matters. I mean, him and his family and stuff. But anyway,
The 2 pieces, are they 2 yards each or a total of 2 yards?
No, I'm sorry, 2 yards each.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And then you pin both layers of the polar fleece to your quilting machine. And the one that you would choose, let's say for the backing, you would pin that to your appropriate rollers. And then you pin your other one separately to your top rollers and stuff. The thing is with polar fleece, it's like minky and it's stretchy. So you don't want to over tighten either one of these. Okay. And because the polar fleece will stretch, but you want to pin the leaders to your machine. Pin the selvage edges of the polar fleece to your machine, to your leaders, I should say, because that's the most straight edge. And polar fleece, as it is cut off the bolt, is usually not even along the cut edges. So just kind of keep that in mind. Now, I know that some of you people like to float your quilt tops, meaning you don't pin the bottom of your quilt top to a leader. I would highly recommend that you not do that with this, that you would pin the bottom of the polar fleece to your bottom leader, just because I think it keeps the tension a little bit better. And even though you might have some stretch, I would prefer to have the stretch equal than having one, let's say the back a little bit tighter than the top, that could be quite a bit looser. And especially with the polar fleece and the fuzz on the polar fleece, I think it really helps keep things together. Now, the other thing with this, just like I said a few seconds ago, the cut edges of your polar fleece the 2 pieces of the polar fleece are probably not going to be even, but don't worry too much about that because we can trim that all up later on. So from the top, which is pinned to the leaders, measure down about 6 or 7 inches, and then you want to draw a line all the way across the whole length of polar fleece. And I think I have a picture, but it's a little bit later on. Then after you do that, then you want to measure in from both sides of the cut edge sides, again, about another 6 to 7 inches. And what I try to do is, and I know I'm gesturing here and hopefully you can see me, but once, let's say your top polar fleece might kind of wiggle a little bit or wave a little bit because of the way they cut, find the closest inside edge and measure from there so that you have another about a good 6 or 7 inches and draw a vertical line, and you do the same thing on the other side. Okay. Now, once you have those lines drawn, that's when you want to stitch along those lines. And I recommend a wavy line. And the main reason is, now this goes back to, you know, garment sewing days, is that being that the polar fleece is a stretched fabric, if you have a straight line of stitching, then if the fabric gets stretched, the seams have a tendency to pop a little bit easier. So if I found that if you do a wavy line, and it doesn't have to be like an exact zigzag, it's just a little bit of a wave in your stitching line, then if the polar fleece fabric stretches, it's not going to be as, it won't, the stitching line won't break as easily. Okay. The thing is, once you establish those wavy lines, both horizontally and vertically, the inside of the wavy lines is where you're going to be quilting. So you're going to leave like a 6 or 7 inch border around this whole piece of polar fleece that has no quilting in it. That's eventually we're going to turn that into fringe. Okay. The one thing that I have found with quilting doing this polar fleece quilted blanket is you have to have a big big open pattern for your quilting. So don't spend a lot of time doing tiny little pebbles. You want to have big open, so swirls. And the one I'm going to show you, I think on the next page, is a big all over freehand feathers and swirls type of a pattern. You want to have this open. You want to have it big. That's why it quilts up so easily and so quickly. Okay, and I know this is not the world's best picture, but bear with me here. I am going to enlarge this a little bit. So hopefully you can see, and let's see here if I can, oh shoot, I can't do that right now. But right along here is the wavy edge, my wavy line that I stitched along the side across about up into here. And I'll draw this out in just a second, is the wavy line across my top. And then that's my quilting, which is big and open. And if you look way over here in that upper, what would that be? The upper left corner, there's a little bit of blue. That's the fabric from underneath. So you can see where this top fabric is not even with the bottom fabric. So let me do this here for a second. Let me go here. Okay, so now I'm in where I can draw. So here's, let's make that a wavy line there. Wavy line across there, quilting in here, this area up here and along the sides, there's no quilting in that. Okay. Then what do we do? Okay. So then in each workspace, measure in from the side edges, mark that line, stitch that with a wavy line, and then continue your quilting until you get down to the bottom of the polar fleece, or almost to the bottom. Okay, now again, the selvage edges, which I'm going to call the bottom edges of the polar fleece, are probably not going to be even. But if you have it where the top fabric is too long, which is what I have in this photo here, and if you can, let's see, where am I at? Okay, let's see. So here's my selvage, not my selvage, this is my leader. And then back down here is where my top fabric is pinned to my bottom leader. And then what I did is I took some straight pins and I marked the straight pins a little bit away from that edge where the leader and the bottom come together under the bottom, on the bottom fabric. Does that make sense? Trying to explain that. Okay. And also, hopefully you can see here where I have the line of stitching here and then a line of stitching here. And again, this area out here is not quilted. This area in here is quilted. Okay. And once you get this area inside of the wavy lines quilted, you're done with the quilting. Okay. And so once you're done with the quilting, now you can take everything off the machine. And it's going to look really, really strange, but hang with me here. So this is the wrong side, or the back side, whatever you want to call it, of what I just showed you. Okay. And I got to tell you, those feathers are probably, I'm going to say, a good 5 or 6 inches across. You know, they're, like I said, they're big. It's big space filling in. Okay. Now, this is probably, it's probably going to take you longer to make the fringe than it does for you to do the quilting. So what I like to do, what I like to do is I have a little small, what they call banquet table. So I put that up in front of my TV in my dining room. I lay this all out, spend an evening or an afternoon sitting there and cutting my fringe. But when you start cutting your fringe, before you start cutting your fringe, I want you to trim this outer area to an even number all four sides. So let's say you measured up about, say, 7 inches, then you still have a couple little raw edges or wavy edges, and then maybe trim that down to 6, maybe 5 inches, whatever. Then from about where this wavy line is up here, which, you know, ends up in here someplace, then I like to put a piece of painter's tape down, because that just stops my rotary cutter. And then I do this on top of my cutting mat, and then just go ahead and just with my rotary cutter, cut a line, move it over an inch, cut another line, cut another line. And you want to do 1-inch cuts all the way across the edge of the quilt. And then you're going to do that all the way over to the other edge, which is what I did. Where are we? Which I did here. And then when you get that edge done, you turn the quilt and you start again. And then in the corner here, you're going to have what, about a 5-6-7-inch piece, however wide your fringe is. You're going to have that piece that's left over so that, you know, you can do something with it or pitch it or whatever or something. And then just keep continuing making your fringe all the way around. And that way, when I get all finished, I just take it and I shake it really good and all that fringe separates and it looks great. And then best of all, that's what it looks like when it's done. underneath all the grandkids, or I should say it underneath, on top of a bunch of grandkids and stuff. So yeah, it's a fairly quick way of making some good stuff. And I got to tell you, I made a bunch of these, what, about 5-6 years ago, and my family is still using them. And actually, I was over at my one daughter's house a couple days ago, and they were still using it. And it's like the polar fleece, the fluffy part of the polar fleece is like all worn off. So guess what they might be getting for Christmas this year? So anyway, I thought I'd just add that in for you guys as a kind of I want to say maybe a Christmas bonus or something, and hopefully you'll enjoy it.
How does that wash up?
Oh, it washes up fabulously, just the same way that, you know, regular polar fleece would wash up.
Okay.
Might take a little bit longer to dry because it's a double layer. I might not put a whole lot of other stuff in the washer when I'm washing it just because it's kind of big and heavy and stuff, but, you know, washes up fine. And actually, to tell you the truth, something like this, I don't mind making it for people, especially my family or whoever, and keeping it in the car. And, you know, sometimes car quilts can get a little trashed, you know. I haven't put a whole, you know, it's not like I spent 2 years piecing something. And if the dogs and the cats get on it, you know, it washes up and it wears forever. So